Zoot. Okay. Yeah. So my first accomplishment of the day. Thank you. Well, thank you, Phoenix. And I'm going to turn it over to you. And thank you again for everyone who's participating and still logging in. We're excited to be with you today.
Thank you so much, James. I didn't realize you're going to read the whole bio. Thank you so much. And thank you for having me. Much gratitude to you and Monica for putting together this beautiful event. And so I don't have much else to say in terms of my intro. I think the work will speak for itself. But before we begin, I would like for us to ground in a land acknowledgement. So if everyone could just take a moment to go internally, connect with the earth beneath your feet, and just take a moment to acknowledge the place that we are and the legacy of the places that we are. And I am coming to you from the traditional territories of the Muscogee Creek Nation lands and lands covered by Treaty 116, also known as Atlanta, Georgia. I wish to take a moment to acknowledge that we are on stolen land, living in countries that were built on the foundation of colonization and genocide that continue until today in many forms. And I would like to take a moment to honor the legacy of many Indigenous tribes across Turtle Island and invite us to be in solidarity with the communities affected the most by the mass graves discovered this year at residential schools across this continent and many more that are left buried across these vast lands. We honor all of our ancestors who have suffered at the hands of imperialism and white supremacy and invite us to move forward grounded in our histories with the spirit of resilience and social change for the empowerment of all oppressed people and the greater good of all humanity and the earth that we live upon. Let us be in our power. And if you could take a moment to take a breath in. Thank you so much. So as James mentioned in the introduction, I am the founder of Voice of Purpose, and I will share my screen. And so Voice of Purpose is an organization that's, most of my work is actually based out of Canada. I've been living in Canada for the last, most of my life actually, and I've been in Atlanta for the last few years. And today I'll be presenting to you grounding in equity with purpose-rooted arts education. And I think there is a lot to consider when we are talking about equity and when we are talking about community arts that we need to keep in mind. So I hope to share with you some of those things. To share a little bit about our organization, we're centered around the mission of purpose. And our mission is to ignite and equip artist educators and arts organizations who embody their purpose to deepen their impact in the world. We believe that in order to really do the larger work that we are here to do, it's important that we are grounded in our purpose, grounded in our missions, and not just from a theoretical way where we are using the language, but we are walking that path. And we feel that folks who are embodied in their purpose actually have greater capacity to do the work of systemic change. And those are some of the things that we offer as an organization. So I'm just going to hop right into it, and we'll open up for questions at the end. So if you have any thoughts around the presentation, please feel free to let us know and write down your questions. Oh, and actually, before we begin, there's going to be a follow-up workshop, just so that you know right off the top. I'm going to be presenting some materials to you today that will be a beginning of a conversation. And Monica, I don't know if you can share the link to the worksheet now in the chat. You won't need to work through this today, but it might be good for you to just have open if you would like to see what's coming up. I will be addressing some of the things that are on this worksheet. But the invitation is for you to take some of these concepts and really work them through your own experience so that we can continue this work, right? And then on the 23rd of September, which is in about 2 weeks, we're going to meet again to use that worksheet as a base to dig deeper into a collective conversation about what this work means for us and help us to ground deeper in the purpose of the work that we do and to empower ourselves in bringing more integrity to the work as it relates to equity and inclusion and community arts and the transformative power of community arts. And so as we head into this work, I think it's really important for us to kind of think about what are some of the things that is the context of the work that we're doing. One of the things actually that I wanted to share with you is that as an organization, we've also been working through some research. So I'm just going to actually, I'll keep the screen up for now. The research that we've been embarking on has been centered around digital and looking at the transition to digital that we've been making as a sector. And through the lens of equity, looking at what are some of the needs of artists in the field right now. And we've come across many different folks from across Canada and the US. James actually was one of our roundtableists. We had a bunch of industry roundtables and artist circles gathering funders and administrators and arts educators and arts learners. From across Canada and the US to engage in conversations about what's been going on. And so some of the presentation that I'll be providing with you today will glean from some of those findings and also provide you with some of the frameworks that we've been working with. And so, one of the things that, as I mentioned earlier, for us to really take in is a scan of what's been going on in the world in a general sense. And in the current generation that is alive on this planet, there seems to be a lost sense of power and purpose amongst many folks. I see this in a lot in my students. I see this in a lot of my colleagues as well, where there is this sense of, because of the systemic oppressions that have been at play, including colonization, racism, patriarchy, heteronormativity, poverty, and all of the other oppressions that come along with the systems that have established the norms of how we exist in the world. There's a sense of, I'm not really quite sure where my place is, and I'm not really quite sure how to really move forward with a sense of power and sense of purpose. And so when we're looking at these things, we realize that when we zoom in, there's a lot of unhealthy patterns and norms that have been formed in our families. There's been a lot of generational trauma. There's been a lot of broken support systems, a lot of mental health issues that are kind of running rampant in the current state of the world today in many of our communities. And I think as community arts organizers, we are directly interfacing with these issues. Whether we name them in this way or not, this is the environment that we are working in. And that moved a little too fast. And so what that's happened, especially in the era of COVID, is that there's this sense of isolation and disconnection. And these oppressive systems have also created a sense of generational marginalization of voices. There's been a lot of suppression and erasure of experiences. There's been a lot of silencing and people working in silos. And as folks working in the field, I'm sure you can resonate with this in that we kind of feel like we're isolated and working on our own sometimes. And this is an issue that affects so many of us. And another thing that comes up is that there is a sense of shame, a sense of I'm not good enough. You know, I'm not enough in some ways, whether that shows up in your work and the pressure that we place on ourselves with the million and one things that come onto our plate that we don't have the capacity for. And it also shows up in our participants, in our communities, because of all of these factors that we are working against the system that has caused us to feel inherently shameful about our identities, about our histories, and about who we are. And so when we talk about transformative community arts engagement, I see this really as the purpose of our work as a sector. And there are some things that we are trying to bring into the world through the work that we are doing. And I've kind of glean this through the work that I've been doing in the field over the last 16 years, but also through the conversations that I've been having recently in our research with all the folks that have been doing this work for a very long time. And one of the things that is really key to this work is this sense of we need to kind of bring in more empowerment to the work that we do. We need to bring in more empowerment to our communities. We need to act as stewards of empowerment through, I think, grounding. And this is some of the power in the work that we do, is that when we center on personal identity and the identity of our communities and centering the cultures and the lived experiences of the people that we are here to serve, this is really the key to unlocking some of the larger aspirations that we have as organizations and as arts creators, is to bring in a sense of agency and to really center the work that we do from a place of greater context, the larger context, but also the specific context of the communities that we're here to serve. And this is something that we heard time and again in our research, is that it's really important for us to be centering our work on the context of the people that we are serving and the communities that we are serving. And so the other piece of our work is really about addressing systemic change. And systemic change through education and implementation. So this is where all the DEI work comes in, when we're thinking about equity and inclusion and accessibility and sustainability. These are about making an impact on a systemic level, because we realize that these systems of, you know, that were on the previous slides of the patriarchy, of colonization, of all of these oppressive systems, have created this need for us to bring the balance back and to bring change. There's an understanding that we need to be bringing a level of change through the work that we're doing as a sector. And this is something that is, I think, a little bit something that happens organically in terms of fostering a sense of care and connection through relationships. A lot of the educators and the administrators that I spoke with and that I work with, there is this sense that we are not just in the classrooms and in the community centers doing art, right? And we're talking about transformative community arts engagement. So maybe I should back up and clarify what that means, because when we're looking at things from the lens of transformative community arts engagement, I'm not necessarily talking about, you know, art history. And when you go to the museums and you learn about the arts, right? And you learn about what happened, of the context of the artists, and the lives that they lived, and it's also not necessarily just doing pretty art, right? Like we've encountered some arts workshops where we're just kind of doing arts and crafts, And there's not really that deeper engagement of the personal. There's not that deeper engagement of the systemic. But when we're talking about transformative community arts engagement, we do need to be taking these into consideration. And the folks that are really doing the work on the ground, this is what they're doing. And a lot of the arts educators that I speak with, they speak to the reality that I'm not just an artist and I'm not just a teacher. I have to play the role of a surrogate parent. I have to play the role of a therapist. I have to play the role of, what some people might relegate to other kinds of social services that are here to support folks on the margins. And that includes providing individual care and collective care around mental and emotional support. And being that space, that safe space where participants can come and talk about the struggles that they've been going through. You know, a lot of folks that I've spoken to and is also my experience is that these youth are coming and these participants are coming and they're coming for the program, but what they really want to do is talk. You know, what they really want is someone to be there for them, to see them, to hear them, to care for them, and to show up for them, and to build that trust, because it's that consistency that's missing in so many of the lives of the people who are on the margins because of the systemic issues that they're facing. And of course, creativity and unity through art creation. And so when we are engaging in transformative community art, it's not just about, you know, making nice things and pretty things. It's about creating a sense of community and a sense of shared humanity through the art creation, through storytelling, through self-expression, and creating a space where folks can really go into that space of sharing. Because when we are open and we are vulnerable, we create avenues for building trust, for building safety, for building rapport, for making it safe to be vulnerable. And this is where the power of the work that we're doing as a sector comes in, is that the arts become a vehicle, right? We're using the arts as a means to impact social change. And that work can be grounded in a greater way when we're able to engage in these things, including empowerment, systemic change, providing care and connection, and creating a sense of creativity and unity through the art creation. So this is just also a nice way of showing how these things are interrelated. These goals and the work that we're doing come together to create authentic impact at its center. Because when we can have these things in alignment and done well and done with integrity and done with accountability and with safety, we open up the potential for the journey of transformation for the communities that we're serving, for ourselves, and also for the participants that are in our rooms together. So how do we do this? How do we do this work? How do we actually embody the work? And this is a framework that I've developed with Voice of Purpose around the elements of purpose. And, you know, oftentimes people will ask me, well, what is purpose? And how do we even begin the work of finding our purpose if you feel lost? And so I've put together, and if you notice, the colors kind of match up. There's a connection between all of these layers because first and foremost, we need to be addressing things on a personal level. There's the importance of centering the individual and the personal life experiences. And so the first element of purpose is really zoning in and looking at what is the specific context, what is the microcosm of this, of who I am, my identities, my intersectionalities, my lived experiences, and what I've experienced on a personal level. And I would also say that this framework works on an individual level. It works also when we're talking about our organizations. So what is the context of the organization? What is the individual experience of the organization and what the mission is? Secondly, we need to look at the systemic. So once we've looked at the micro, we need to zoom out and have a context of the macro. So that's understanding the social, cultural, historical contexts of the world that we are living in. And in combination, when we bring the personal with the systemic together, we delve into the realm of integration. And the importance of approaching this work from a holistic sense, so that we're taking into consideration of what's happening on a micro level, but we're also doing this work in the context of understanding what's happening on the macro level. How is my personal experience informed and influenced and shifted and changed and colored through the understanding that I'm not living in a bubble? There's a lot of experiences that I've had as an Asian woman walking through the world that are informed by the systems of racism, by the systems of patriarchy, by the systems of sexism. All of these things inform the path that we walk. And so when we get into a space of really trying to understand our purpose and ground in our purpose, it's the integration work that is necessary to take place. And then of course, heading into creation, once you've understand your personal context in the larger context and you bring the two together and you are grounded in what it is that you have experienced in the context of all of that, then we can move forward into the realm of creation where we can express and innovate and build and birth things into existence. So again, this applies on a personal level and it also can apply on an organizational level as well when we are thinking about what's the purpose of our organization, how can we do this work of our mission statements with greater integrity. Is we need to be taking all of these components into consideration as we're building our work. So purpose-rooted arts education is an extension of the elements of purpose. And so when we take each one of the elements and we dive deeper, we get into an approach of what do we need to center? And what do we need to assess and how do we need to assess the frameworks that we're working with? And how do we create change? What are the building blocks? And what is the direction in each one of these elements that we need to do and engage to do the work that we're doing in a greater depth and of greater impact? So as it relates to the personal, something that I kind of previously mentioned is that we need to ground into our sense of identity and authenticity. What are the intersections of my identity? What are the intersections of the identities of my staff? What are the intersections of the identities of the participants and of the communities that we are serving? And centering that and moving towards authenticity. You know, how can we be more authentic about being real, about who we are, what we've experienced? How can we help our communities and our participants move greater into a sense of authenticity about who they are and the work that they're doing and the lived experiences that they have? And so this aspect, and if you check out the worksheet that Monica has dropped in the chat, you'll also be sent this post-conference as well. And again, it connects back to the work that we'll be doing in the follow-up workshop on the 23rd of September, is really about how do we do this work? You can't really do this work without opening up spaces of honesty and vulnerability, right? And so that's one of the keys as well, is how do we become more authentic? Well, authenticity requires vulnerability because we spend so much of our time walking around with these masks on to try and protect. Because as I mentioned previously, the systems of oppression have caused us to feel so much shame about who we are has caused us to feel such deep unworthiness about who we are. And that not enoughness causes us to put on masks, causes us to create these personas that may not be the true authentic expressions of who we are. And when we are asked to take that mask off, it's really important that we, it's necessary. You can't do that work without going into spaces of vulnerability, and that takes courage, right? And that takes safe space. It takes honesty and realness. So how can we invite ourselves and our participants to be more real? Equity and inclusion is, of course, the direction that we're moving in as a sector. You know, a lot of the roundtables and the conversations and the artist circles and things that we've been hosting, so many people are like, we are talking about equity and inclusion a lot. I can't walk into a room in our sector, in the work that we're doing, without this conversation, which is a great thing, which is really awesome. This is the direction that we need to be working in. We need to be thinking about how can we deepen in our work around equity? How can we be more inclusive? How can we be more accessible? How can we be more sustainable? And I think also something that I've heard a lot as a feedback is that we're talking a lot about it, but how do we actually do more of this work on the ground? And I think it requires us to, and when we're talking about the systemic, I'm not just talking about historical context, right? Although I am talking about the historical context. It's also about what are the systems that run our lives and what are the systems that are in place in our organizations? Are the systems in place and the policies and the procedures in within our organizations equitable? Are they inclusive? Is the way that I move through the world and the systems that exist in my life, am I making space for inviting in a greater sense of collectivity in the work that I'm doing? And so it's not just about thinking about these terms and using the words and using the verbiage to kind of get a pass through the door and get into the club, which happens a lot, right? And this is something that I've noticed happening a lot at you know, when I've sat on grant juries, is that everyone's using this language. It's almost like your green card to get in through the door. But how are you actually living up to these mandates? And so taking a real critical lens at what is the this real systemic engagement of the work that we're doing is something that is necessary. In the space of integration, we need to talk about healing and well-being. You know, all that generational trauma, all of that broken systems, all of the broken support systems has caused us into this space where we are not well as a human society. Our systems are sick. Our bodies are sick. We have a pandemic going on. There's a lot of mental health issues that are going unaddressed and unsupported. And so how can we bring in a greater sense of healing and well-being and really naming that and really walking forward in some of the techniques that we have available to our disposal? Creativity and collectivity. And also creativity and technique, right? How are we inviting in a sense of excellence to the work that we do? Not excellence from kind of an imperial colonial sense, but excellence in the terms of integrity, right? In terms of the systems that we're bringing in terms of the work that we're doing in the classroom, in terms of how we're building the systems in our organizations. Are we creating a sense of collectivity? Are we creating a sense and of being innovative, of being forward-thinking in the work that we're doing? So these are the frameworks that we work with that comprise purpose-rooted arts education. And these are here, and one reflection I can offer back about the sector is that these are things that we are trying to do, and these are things that I think a lot of us believe in, but there aren't real solid systems in place that we can borrow from. You know, we're kind of having to patch the work together because we realize that it's needed. You know, and so if you are running organizations and you're in positions of leadership, I really encourage you to think about how are we implementing these things on the ground, and not just from a mission standpoint, but from a systemic standpoint. And I'll just give an example from my own experience. When I first started teaching, you know, I was 19, working with 11 to 14 year olds. And we were doing after school programs in an organization called Lost Lyrics. And, you know, we were using hip hop as a tool to engage in conversations about social justice and talking about what was happening in the community. And, you know, there was a lot of violence, there was a lot of police brutality, and a lot of targeting, and a lot of systemic oppression that was going on. And some of our young people were coming to us and telling us, you know, things that they didn't trust their teachers with, they didn't trust their social workers with, you know, and we had these 12-year-old girls coming to us, telling us about the abuse that they were facing. And we, as, you know, in our late teens, early 20s, we're like, we are not equipped to really support these young people when they're telling us about, you know, some sexual abuses that were happening at home and the violence that they're seeing happening out in the community. And so I had to take it upon myself to pursue the study of psychotherapy, because I realized that I wasn't equipped to really support the work that needed to be done, and that was being called for. And so this is kind of just an anecdote to show you that it's happening, but we're doing the patchwork version of it. Right. So I encourage you to think about how are we equipping our artists and our teachers and the folks who are on the front lines with the tools to be able to actually do this work. When we're sending artists into the communities, are we equipping them truly with tools to implement equity and inclusion on the ground? What kind of training are they receiving? Are they receiving support around their own healing and well-being? Are they being given tools of how to implement this on the ground for their participants and to really hold that space for them? Are we equipping them with the tools to think creatively, to be innovative, to have excellence in their techniques and foster a sense of collectivity? And are we helping them to ground in their own sense of identity and authenticity? So I leave that question with you for further reflection. And so this is kind of like the dreamscape, right? Like, what are we hoping for? And what can we achieve with some of these principles if we implement them on the ground? Is that we can have healthy individuals and communities, people and communities that are grounded in their purpose, that feel fulfilled about their lives, that feel purposeful and resourced and with the agency to create the change. We are working towards creating healthy systems that provide support and resources for the growth and thriving of all, you know, and we focus in on the marginalized communities because that's kind of where it's lacking the most because of the unhealthy systems. But ultimately, we're trying to bring in a greater sense of support and greater resources for the growth. And when we have kind of reached the end of the line, the hope is that we have a real sense of holistic integration. We have healthy and holistic approaches that are normalized, not happening in little pockets where we're doing the patchwork, but they're woven into the systems and how we operate. They're normalized. It's normalized to talk about mental health. It's normalized to have tools of how to deal and address mental health issues for yourself and for the folks that you're serving. And they're integrated into all aspects of our lives and the work that we do. And ultimately, we're striving for freedom. We're striving for power in, not from a power over, but having a collective base of power. We're striving towards unity. We're striving towards real empowerment when folks feel free and safe to be who you are without the fear of being judged, without the fear of persecution, when there is a real sense of harmony and the embodiment of one's purpose and the power to make the changes that we want to create in the world. So this is the dream, right? I think this is all what we're, the light at the end of the tunnel that we're hoping to build. And this work takes generations. We are just a small blip on the map. But if we have a sense of this is the continuum and this is the ultimate kind of point of impact that we're striving for, then we have at least a true north to guide us. And the frameworks that we work with, which I've, you know, some of the frameworks I've shared with you can provide a sense of foundation for how to do the work and what are the components that we need to be considering. So this is something that is goes deeper into in the worksheets that I have provided you. If you go to voiceofpurpose.org/groundyourpurpose, you'll find a worksheet that was created for this piece that we're doing now and for the work that we'll be doing. And let me see if this is going to do, yeah, it's going to do individual ones. So there's a journey when we're on that path of transformation and we are striving towards our growth. There are key things that we need to open ourselves to understand what is it that we're really striving towards and what is it that we're doing. And first we need to explore. We need to do that deep exploration into the personal. And then we need to engage from an authentic place, from a real place, from implementation of through the exploration, what have we discovered, and then engaging with it in a real way. And then once we've engaged with it, we work toward the embodiment of these things, right? We're not just talking about it. We're not just, you know, doing little things here and there, but we are walking as the embodiment of these principles. So how can we strive towards that? And how are we activating? Once we've gone through the process of exploring, engaging, and embodying, how do we activate the work? How do we activate these principles in our own lives and in the lives of the folks that we serve? And so this is kind of the framework actually for the work that we'll be doing in the follow-up workshop again on September 23rd at 2 p.m. Eastern time. We'll be spending 90 minutes from 2 to 3:30. So that's on Thursday. And if you have your calendars available open right now, I encourage you to just kind of take a look and block that off right now. Monica will be sending you follow-up emails with more details. And this is a continuation of the conference that we're having right now in this presentation. And the worksheets, which you can find here, will be able to kind of support you. So in the worksheet is also a resource guide. So some of the things that I presented to you around the principles and around the frameworks are also provided as an introduction in this worksheet. And it also provides you space and some critical questions for you to reflect on and journal about. And then when we get back together on the 23rd, we will be taking up those questions. You'll have an opportunity to share with your colleagues. You'll have an opportunity to go deeper into the reflection of these questions so that we have a collective base of support to implement this work in our own lives and in the ways that we're moving forward. Monica, do you have anything you'd like to say about this piece?
I was just going to share, it looks like we have a couple of points in the chat. I'm not sure if you can see those, but you know, Charlie Newton had a great point. He's actually, let me start with Shanna. Shanna said, great point. If the structural systems don't change, there is no real change. Talking about it is not enough. Then Charlie Newton brought up, most of the training is from the top down. How can we provide opportunity to hear from the bottom up?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely. So I think maybe, to address these questions. Sorry, this is another workshop thing. Okay, so I'm gonna stop sharing my screen so that we can engage in a bit more of a conversation. So that's perfect timing because we have some time, about 10 minutes to do some Q&A. And so we can start with these comments and yeah, absolutely. Talking about it is absolutely not enough. And that's kind of what's mostly happening right now in our sector. And talking about it as a starting point, it helps us to kind of ground a little bit in the things in providing context about what is it that we need to talk about, but it doesn't make the change happen, right? And so part of that is absolutely coming from the bottom up. So many of our systems, even, you know, as progressive as we like to think of ourselves to be in the community arts sector, our sector is still created in the image of the colonial framework, right? We have the funders at the top who develop their strategic plans and have their ideas about what's needed. They craft the grant guidelines, and then we have to adhere to those grant guidelines and hue what we really want to do to the language that they're using at the time to be, you know, to gain access to the funding. And then we, you know, we do what we can. We do, you know, we work within the confines that were came down from the bottom, from the top, to service the folks that really need it. And then we have to report back up, right? And so how do we dismantle this system, and how can we think more creatively? And this happens also in a microcosm in our organizations as well, right? We have the board of directors who have the final say about what goes on. And sometimes they're making decisions about the things that are impacting folks on the ground when they're so removed, you know, and a lot of the people who sit on our boards are there because of their professional credentials, right? And that's kind of how our boards are made up. And to have a community member sitting on your board is kind of an innovative thing, right? Like it's, ooh, we're doing something that's a little bit outside of the framework. And the reality is, it should be flipped around on its head altogether as a system, right? And so, yeah, that absolutely. And so I think that requires of us to be, again, innovative. It requires us to be creative, knowing that this is the reality and knowing that, you know, if we're really trying to do transformative work in our sector, we have to think about decolonizing the systems that we're working with. And that includes the top-down approach. And really going to the base of the communities that we're working with and hearing from them. You know, there's actually some folks we spoke with at the funder table. We held a bunch of industry roundtables, and at the funder table, there are actually some funders who are co-creating granting programs with the communities that are most marginalized and taking that input. So we have the agency, we have the power, we just kind of have to have the courage and the gusto and the boldness to do it. So are there any other questions that folks have or any other comments that folks would like to share? What about a system that is not top down or bottom up, but shared sociocracy or holocracy? Could you maybe provide a definition for sociocracy or holocracy? Because I'm not sure if these are terms that everyone would be familiar with.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
So actually, I've just been researching these two. There are many more, but these two systems are the ones that I've been researching because I'm trying to implement it within my own organization, but they're based on circles rather than hierarchies. Well, I take that back. Holocracy is actually what they would say, a holistic hierarchy, so that it's based on roles, not power, I guess. So it's always shared power, that every role has authority to within its circle. Sociocracy is, I think, even more decentralized in that they have, and they also talk about circles, but they're groups that are focused on, for instance, in one that I'm looking at, we'll be talking to them tonight, actually. It's called Sociocracy for All, but they have circles. One circle is for education. So people who are interested in the topic of education, they're working in that circle. And within the circle, they vote on a leader, they vote on a secretary, they vote on a representative that will go, that will interface with the other circles. So basically the organization has a mission circle, which is kind of what we would call a board. But the mission circle is not the one who has the final say. It's the whole group that has the final say in anything. So, I mean, there's a lot of, you can Google sociocracy or holocracy, and they're very structured. They're very there are very clear guidelines about how to run a meeting, about how to run your organization, about how to share the power, but they're not, you know, we have all the power and you guys have to do what I say. Absolutely. Does that help?
Yeah, absolutely. It is absolutely about power sharing, and it's about power distribution, and it's about folks having a real say, because I think sometimes we can form these committees that are community-based, but then they don't actually have decision-making power. So what is that even doing? It's kind of tokenism, right? So there's absolutely a need for implementing these models within our organizations that are examples of true power sharing. Of folks, and absolutely, thank you so much for sharing that. And if you have any links to that work, I encourage you to share them in the chat. I realize I missed a comment from Karen saying, greetings all, cannot begin to say how much I have heard that artists over several forms of media are stereotypically labeled as suffering or starving or some form of depraved. That is what feeds their work. That concept needs to be changed, right? Absolutely. Absolutely. I think that sense of unworthiness that I spoke to earlier feeds into so much of how we view our work. You know, we're the artists are kind of relegated to the peddlers, like, buy my stuff, you know, and there's this sense of the stereotype of the starving artist, like, it doesn't work. It's not cute. Can we get rid of that? You know, can we see ourselves as empowered creators in the world? And I think that starts internally first with ourselves, to realize that we are worthy, that the work that we have and that we create is absolutely powerful. And we need also systems of support, right? Because the lack of resources is a real thing, right? The funding is limited. In terms of what's available out there. But again, that requires us to be innovative, right? We can't just stay couched in the systems that oppress us and be okay with it, right? There needs to be a sense of, let's create more power for ourselves. And how can we do that from a place of not feeling like I'm struggling, but from a place of knowing like I am worthy and the work that I do is powerful. And I'm calling that power into myself. And that's where some of that healing work comes in as well for all of us as artists and those of us who have kind of fed into those ideas that we are under-resourced. And at the same time, there's that balance, right? Because having the resources and not having the resources is a real thing. One of the panelists that we spoke with recently, an Indigenous artist named Zoe Roy, said it at one of our industry roundtables that decolonization is expensive. It is. It's really expensive. It's expensive in terms of our capacity. It's expensive in terms of our human resources, our financial resources, because it requires us to do so much lifting, right? Of dismantling of the system. Dismantling a system isn't a simple thing. It takes a lot of capacity. So how do we approach this work where we're where we're resourced in a more holistic way so that we can do this work, knowing that it's going to take so much capacity? And I also just want to honor that it's really hard. This is not easy stuff, right? Especially when you're feeling and you are at a place where your organization is not well resourced, you're kind of running around patching roofs everywhere. Right. And you run over to this house and you patch this hole over here. And then you realize this one's falling through and you patch this over here and you patch this over here. And when you're in the process of doing that, you don't necessarily have the real time or the capacity to look at the foundation of the entire building structure to realize that it's the way that the house is built, why these holes are happening. Right. So that it's a real thing. I see one more comment here. I love Canada, lived there for 5 years, Toronto, what? Yes, and found it to always be more progressive than the US on inclusion, et cetera. Do you find Canada ahead of us in your areas of expertise, and are there things we can learn from them? Well, that's an interesting question. Canada is a different context, I think. There's a lot of similarities between the US and Canada in terms of our cultural influences and the history of colonization, but there's also a lot less people in Canada. The land is vast and the people are few. And in our metropolitan areas like Toronto, obviously, there's a lot of things that mirror some of the struggles here in the more populated areas in the US. But I think there is a different base of reality. And so I think there's a lot of co-learning. I think there's a lot of learning that can happen between the two countries, which is part of the reason when we did our roundtables recently, we invited Canadians and Americans to sit at the table together and really share about our experiences, because there is a lot that can be learned. And in a general sense, when you're working with a smaller base, there can be more flexibility on what you can do. And also, you know, we do have, I guess, a few more social systems in place, like the healthcare system and these sorts of things that provide some base, but it's still the same folks who are marginalized here are the same folks that are marginalized in Canada. Police brutality still happens in Canada, right? Racism still happens in Canada. I think there's, being in Atlanta for the last few years, I've realized that there definitely is a different relationship, not different, but there are nuances to, for example, the Black identity. Right? Because so many of the base of Black Americans come from the history of the transatlantic slave trade. And slavery did happen in Canada, don't get me wrong, right? Fun fact, or little known fact, is that the first Underground Railroad went from Quebec down into the States, right? So there was slavery in Canada. However, the current population of Black Canadians are immigrant based. So they're from mainland Africa, West Coast, they're from the Caribbean, who also face the history of slavery, but from a different, slightly different context. So there's a lot of issues that center around newcomers, a lot of focus around, you know, these kinds of nuances. So I think there's a lot to be learned back and forth. I think this could be like a whole conversation in and of itself. I can't really pluck kind of like, well, this is something Canada's doing really well, and like, y'all are sucking at this, so you should need to learn from us, other than the healthcare system, of course. But in our sector, one example that I'll provide at the Toronto Arts Council, which is the municipal funding body, there is a new kind of funding stream that was created in collaboration with community and Black artists, which was headed up by Tamaj Garad. She works, I forget exactly what the fund is called, but it's centered around Black artists. And the funding structure and the proposals were shaped in collaboration with Black artists who are working artists. So these sorts of things are happening. Again, they're the minority, right? Because the majority of the work that is happening is still trapped within the same systemic issues that folks face in the US. But there are, you know, glimmers and experiences where people are being more innovative. And also that's happening down here too. There's a lot of people in the States who are working in really innovative ways to think outside of the box. That's basically I guess what I can say about that is that there's a lot of co-learning to be had. And I really invite all of you to continue to have conversations with folks that you have access to in other places, from other contexts, even within your own city, right? People who come from different socioeconomic placements, people who come from different racial backgrounds, people who with different gender identities. There's so much that we can learn from one another. And I think that's part of the power of this work, and part of what we need to be doing is that base of collectivity, right? We need to be learning from one another. We need to be including everybody at the table, and not just the people that are always the easiest to kind of call out, right? Yeah, I think Linda shared a link. Yes, and please do share with one another as you go through this day. And as I said already, we will be connecting again In 2 weeks' time, mark your calendars on the 23rd. If you don't already have downloaded the worksheet and resource guide that I've provided you, you can go to voiceofpurpose.org/groundyourpurpose, which will be the center of the next workshop that we do. And Monica will be sending a link out. And I think the link was already kind of sent. So you can check for that. Anything else you'd like to share, Monica or James?
No, thank you. I'll just say thank you. I mean, I've been really energized by your talk this morning and able to, go back and do what I do, but look at it through a lot of different